Welcome to another episode of IHNA and IHM Career Australia. I'm Vinesh Balan. Today we have Sulal with us and we'll discuss on a few aspects on how to climb up on, once you get into career, how to climb up the ladder. We have touched in the different episodes, we have touched on how to get into a particular role and what are the different opportunities here in Australia. Today we'll discuss on how to climb up the ladder. So welcome Sulal.
Thank you, Vinesh.
So we can start with sharing your story, how you started over here and where you're at right now.
Yeah. Yep, sure. So not a long story, primarily it's a short story. I came to Australia in 2016. I primarily came to Northern Territory, so I landed up in Darwin. And my first job I'm still in the same job. I'm working as the HR senior executive officer for workforce strategy and planning with Daniel Dilba Health Service. When I started in 2016, I started as an HR manager for Daniel Dilba, and that was my first interview in Australia. So it was it was good to crack the first interview.
That's very rare.
Yeah. So it wasn't. I didn't expect it happened that way, but I'm glad that it happened that way. And then in 2018, there was a position, which I mentioned now, the current position I'm in, which is more of a head of HR position, one of the executive leadership position. When we had that opportunity, I applied for that job and I've got promoted into the head of HR position, now working with the senior leadership team within the organization.
That's brilliant. Yeah. Thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
So now coming to career growth, at what point does someone look for, what's the next step? When does someone decide when to look for the next step?
Okay. See, there is no one answer for that. It's primarily, every organization is different and every organization's context is different. But I think some of those options you have is you actually have to look at where the organization is going and also what are the growth elements of an organization. For example, within an organization there may be some parts of the organization rapidly growing and some may not, and so you have to see where the organization is going. And primarily you can understand those things by looking at the strategic plan of the organization, looking at talking to some of the senior leaders, what are the future plans of the organization. So that actually helps you to think about what are some of those options coming up in the near future, and then see yourself how you can connect with those opportunities and see if that is something that is suitable for you. That is one way of looking at it. The other ways of looking is your career interest. So within, if you are working in a particular department, you have to see about the team structure and how the team is working and what is the team has for the future. That also helps you to understand if you are working in a larger team, what are the opportunities coming for the members in the team. So these are the two things I would say to start with.
So it's very much tied with the organization and the team's future and strategic plans.
Yeah,
you'd say that, right?
Yeah. So because sometimes if you go into a big team, it may be difficult for you to just climb the ladder quickly, because some businesses are slow, or some businesses got a steady growth and some grow rapidly. Mm-hmm. So I think the career growth is mainly in the businesses where there is rapid growth, of course, sometimes you don't have the choice, like which organization you want to work with. Primarily, you see a role and you just take that job. But you have to see in terms of if you're working there for 2-3 years, then you actually have to look to see what are the different career pathways within the organization. And so you actually can see yourself, whether you are, is there a pathway which is suiting you and also the organization. If not, you actually have to see what else is your option. But it's good to have that understanding in an earlier stage that actually also keep you motivate if you are looking for a career growth.
Right. So it's very important to have the big picture rather than being very individually focused.
Absolutely.
So to touch on one more question regarding what you asked, what sort of hierarchies do you see here in Australian market? In other countries, I know we start in a junior position and slowly climb up the ladder.
Yep.
But over here, I see primarily a flat structure, so it's a bit hard to climb up the ladder. So what are your thoughts on that?
That is actually, it's a very good question, and it's actually based on the industry you are in. For example, in IT, there may be a more flat structure. And then, for example, in health service, it may not be that flat because of how the operations work or the compliance. The compliance requirements are different. So it varies based on industry to industry. But however, sometimes I think it's also good to know, what's the structure the organization has. And some of the organization, even though they're flat, they think the one of people are the biggest assets. So in those circumstances, they actually have got opportunities for everyone. So it doesn't mean that you don't see that as career growth just as you going into a leadership position. But what they do is they actually set out the career pathways where they have specialist pathways and leadership pathways. I will talk about context from a health service with the organization I am working. So we got leadership pathways where nurses can become nursing managers and they become general managers. They can become head of clinical governance, so they at the end of that they can become the CEO. Some people may not want that. The career growth means they wanted to get specialized within the nursing, or they wanted to get specialized within a particular area of health. So we also offer pathways where they can then go and do they may be a nurse and then they do midwife, so they may become a midwife, and then they may want to do nurse practitioner, so they become nurse practitioner, and it's a very specialized area. So the advantage of both are, that's actually what people's interest, and secondly, most of the organizations in Australia actually promote those different pathways, so it's not just linear. Rather, I would say you can actually select from a plenty of different options. So you actually have, when you work with the organization, you can actually find out what are those. That's why I said in the earlier question, you actually have to find out your interest and what are the different pathways available within an organization that actually helps you then to build your skills. Sometimes you may have to do some upskilling because you may not have all of that skills, and then some of these roles actually need you to build some skills. For example, I've mentioned about the nurse to nurse practitioner, which is actually a totally different level of skill set, and even from the point of Medicare billing, where you can actually earn a bigger revenue for the organization if you're a nurse practitioner. So there are different pathways which one can choose from, and I think Australia as a country offers such exciting opportunities for anyone who actually wanted to grow their career. So I have seen many people, particularly from a migrant background, they may because many people are from health background, you see them starting as a nursing position, but rather you see in, if you're in another country, they will work all the time as a nurse, but here you see people do masters or further postgraduate studies to ensure that they are geared up for the future opportunities.
Yeah, the reason I asked that is, as I said, in IT, and I'm from India, so the way that works over here is you start as in a junior position, slowly get into senior position, then manager, then BU manager, and that's how it goes. But here, I see people working as a software developer for like 20 years. And if you're a manager, you might have less than 2 years experience, and you're a manager. So that's a completely different ladder. So the ladders are important over here, and it's important to focus on that.
That's right.
So now, how do you build the skills for your next level? What sort of skills to build, or how to go about that?
Okay. So I think I've just touched on some of those in the previous answer, by saying that you have to upskill sometimes yourself. So I would say it in two ways. One is you upskill yourself, if you're particularly looking for a leadership position, or you're looking for a specialist position where you clearly knows where do you stand in terms of your skills, and then you can see what else is needed to reach that particular level. So you may do formal learning in that way. Secondly, it's not only about formal learning. Earlier people used to call soft skills, now that has become essential skills. So, you know, when you talk about those essential skills, don't think that, you know, we know everything, you know. Absolutely, it's a ever-changing world and the change is very rapid, so you need to adapt all the time. So there are you know, essential skills we need to build all the time, and particularly communication, interpersonal skills, things like that. Yes, we may be strong in some of those, but sometimes, you know, there may be areas of improvement within that area. So we actually have to reflect ourselves to understand where do we stand in terms of our skill set, and then we actually start to build, you know, what is missing or what is that something we need to develop ourselves. That actually, you know, it's, so it's based on individual to individual, but you need to reflect on yourself and then start building on it.
You should definitely invest in essential skills.
Yes, absolutely.
I highly recommend that.
Yeah.
Another question that I sometimes get from a few migrants as well, you know, as a migrant, it's hard to climb up the ladder, you know, it's the cultural difference. You're not set up for that. Is that true? Of course, you climbed up the ladder, so you'd be a great example on whether it impacted you or how did you overcome it, or is there a real thing like that?
So. I can't say I am a great example yet, you know, it's still going on the ladder.
You made it, so yeah.
But I would say it's also about our perceptions, and you know, like what I've experienced is, I would say, you know, we as an individual, you know, we have to first accept that we came to another country, so we also came to another culture as well. So when we came to another culture, where you also see a diversified, you know, set of people at a large number of nationalities from different countries. People may not think, you know, how much culture will influence everyone, but at the end of the day, you know, everyone has got this culture in the back of the mind, and people actually would see, they can actually see the difference if you're really adaptable or not. You know, to give you an example, the way you deal with your team, you know, or the way you, like for example, many Australians, you know, they go even for professional, you know, relationship or friendship, they actually go out together. You know, sometimes they have team lunch, or sometimes, you know, you the way you crack jokes, you know, the how much you see some of those programs in Australia. So every small thing matters, and what it tells, you know, when you particularly deal with leadership, and then when you talk to them, you actually have to relate, you know. So you, if you don't relate, and if they are unable to have a good context while you talk, just not about the work but in general about the different things you discuss, they will not be comfortable in, you know, providing you another position, because they will have a concern that how others will see it. But if you adapt yourself, you know, you understand that, okay, this is something that I really need to work on. I wanted to make sure that, you know, people see me as part of the team, you know, they've actually give me value because how I interact and how I talk to them and talk to everyone, you know, the way you give respect, that actually earn everyone's respect, and that actually help to bridge that cultural differences and then bring more confidence in the leadership. And what then happens is, you know, leadership, if you are looking for such roles, or, you know, whichever, based on your individual circumstance in an organization, that actually build confidence in the leadership team for you to, for promoting you.
Absolutely. And if you're in Melbourne, you definitely have to watch footy. That's sports is a big thing.
Yes, yes.
So you, if you love sports, make sure that you express that.
Yes.
Fact, and it has a big thing.
Yeah.
Now, how do you go about, I mean, did mentoring impact your, you know, your career growth? You know, sometimes people think, you know, how can I go for mentoring? I'm trying to take my boss's job, so how can I ask him for help? So how does mentoring work over here, or what impact does it have in
So I think within the organization, mentoring, you know, may not be a formal structured approach unless the organization has a mentoring program with the intention of developing future leaders. Yes, like, you know, if you look at Woolworths or Coles or some big organizations, they may have a structured mentoring program because they're always growing, you know, and they've got a lot of leadership opportunities. Now, you know, discrimination happens, so, you know, not doesn't happen. That's a different thing altogether. But they've got programs which are actually trying to promote or, you know, generate future leaders. In other organizations, it's not as structured as big organizations. So it's primarily about your own initiative, you know. So what I used to do is I used to go and talk to my CEO or the deputy CEO when, you know, there is a time when I think they've got some time, and asking for general feedback, you know, what do you think, you know, this is not any formal feedback, but can you give me some feedback on how is, you know, how am I going and how is the organization going, is there something else we need to do, you know. So it actually, it's more about instilling that thinking that, you know, you are concerned about the organization, you want to actually grow with the organization and you want to contribute more. And sometimes those questions ends up in getting more work, you know, but
it's part of it,
you know. Yeah. So you actually have to see when they start giving such work to you, that means they've got an interest and they are actually, you know, building a hope that you are actually enjoying the work and you wanted to do more. So, you know, you actually have to use those opportunities to prove yourself. And then, you know, when you do such work with them, naturally you're getting mentored.
Yeah.
You know, that's one way. And I haven't got any formal mentoring from my organization, but working closely with the CEO or the deputy CEO actually gave me a lot of opportunity to, you know, talk a lot of other things, coming up with a lot of new ideas, and some of them, you know, we in fact implemented. So, and even that helped me in different ways, because our organization wasn't in the, you know, limelight in Australian HR, you know, landscape, where in 2018 we got the Australian HR Institute Stan Grant Indigenous Employment Award.
Yeah,
you know, so
great.
Yeah, so that made me proud, and, you know, of course the organization proud, the CEO proud, the board proud. So there's a big ripple effect of that, you know, one small thing. And it may not be small thing, but, you know, the way people see is totally different. So I think that kind of, you know, your inputs or your initiatives are important in the first instance, and that may end up you getting some, you know, support like this. Secondly, what helped me is I mentored a number of people, particularly HR professionals, using Australian HR Institute mentoring program, and it was a great learning experience for me, primarily because, you know, I've come from a different background, so I've never done a formal mentoring program. So this program actually offers you some formal learning to how to do mentoring, so it actually does provide you some professional development opportunities. And then when you do this mentoring, you know, the way people their thinking and how they, you know, what they're lacking and what's the way they are looking at careers, it's all new information for you, because you know you haven't experienced that before.
Yeah.
And then you give those solutions. What the best thing happened during the mentoring was when I gave some solutions to one of my mentees, they were really happy and they really wanted to go and do it, you know. And it's not big things, it's about, you know, small things at a time, but that made her happy, me happy. The entire mentoring program worked out well.
Yeah.
So I think it's both ways. So if I was thinking that, you know, I cannot mentor because I'm from, you know, not from Australia,
yeah,
I would have not got that learning opportunity. So you actually have to be confident that whatever you have got is something you can also give. It's not only you can take, you also got content which you can give. So you actually work based on that confidence, and then it's both ways.
It's always give and take,
yep,
isn't it? So
yep,
mentoring is so powerful that it gives you confidence, and
yes,
you learn a lot.
Yeah.
And that giving definitely will come back one day.
Absolutely.
And, you know, help you out,
yep,
as well.
Yep.
Now I see a common theme over here. You know, sometimes technical skills are not enough.
Mm.
You have to do something more to stand out.
Yep.
What sort of things can you do to stand out over here?
Again, it's a smart thing, you know, people have to do.
Yeah.
But I think some of those things you can do is, for example, particularly if you're working, even you're working in a manager role, you know, you wanted to become a manager, or, you know, going up the ladder, you know, a general manager, or, you know, head of a particular department. I think where you have to start is mainly with, you know, look at the organization strategy. You know, what is that you are doing? This is more from a business perspective. You know, people can take it in the context based on what they work. Like from a business perspective, you know, you may have to look at what's the business planning, you know, what are the key performance indicators. And then you come up with solutions.
Mm.
You know, so every business has got problems, you know, and then many times when you see people talking about problems, what happens is they become more complex, you know. So if you some of you might have heard of one of the interview from Indra Nui, the CEO of the former CEO of PepsiCo, and it was really interesting to see that she was saying, what people, you know, why people come to you is the, one of the questions in a, if an organization. And to her, people used to come because they, she could make complex problems to simple issues, you know. So she made complex issues to simple and then solve it. So that kind of an feedback, you know, when there is a problem, there you should make it in a such a way that he's the person to go to or she is the person to go to.
Right.
You know, so you actually have to do, you know, some big picture thinking. So whenever you get opportunities to, you know, talk in a staff meeting or in a team meeting, you should, you know, should not be concerned about what others think. Rather, you should actually spill out your ideas and see, you know, what works. And sometimes if you don't have ideas, but you can think of and, you know, come back at other time, you know, going back to your manager or senior leader asking, I couldn't contribute yesterday, but I've had a thought about it overnight and these are some of the, you know, ideas I came up with. So it all shows about your commitment and dedication and how much thinking in terms of, you know, rather than just doing things, how much of thinking works on someone's mind. And organization needs all, not only doers, they need thinkers as well, because, you know, mainly the actions comes after your thinking. So those are some of the ways I think you can start doing small things which will help you to eventually stand out.
It's important to think, implement and act on it, yeah, rather than just doing your 9-to-5 job, I'd
yes,
say,
yes,
right?
Yeah. And this may actually end up in you spending more time, you know, sometimes. But what helps is, and I am not telling, you know, anyone to do more, spend more time on your job. Rather, it's about how smartly you spend your time balancing off different things, you know. So it's not about you spending more time. Of course, if you get another project which is exciting, you know, you may spend. That's a good learning experience. But it's about how smart you, you know, you make that your presence feel.
Now, you do all this to stand out, you think, you contribute, you're very eager, curious to learn. How do employers view all this activity? I mean, how do they judge or how do they, you know, rank you? What do employers think?
Yeah. I've got some experience in that because, you know, when you work in a leadership team, you also hear what the leadership says about, you know, they've pondered, not in, it's not about, you know, what do you call it? It's not about organization, you know, any drama, but rather it's about how a CEO would have seen someone working. You know, for example, I was working yesterday with my CEO, and she was telling me one particular staff member who was working in getting us some new funding, and particularly this is not in our key area of business. This is like, you know, if we actually going out of the comfort zone and doing some totally new business in within the health service, but totally, you know, new area of business. And the way he, you know, came up and the way he wrote the funding applications was quite good. And, you know, we're likely to get some of those funding. And then he, we are giving him the work of, now how do you implement after this, once you become successful? Now, yes, it's more work, but we are also thinking now, you know, so he is a valuable resource. Now, how do we want to raise him, you know, leverage his skills and capabilities, because he has got a good set of, and it's a young person, you know, the person has got a law background and he has got, you know, very good communication skills, and rather than his, you know, that analytical thinking is pretty good. So we ourselves are thinking, you know, how do we leverage the skills and, you know, make him a better asset for the organization. So see, the employers, they, he would have started from a, such a small level, you know, working as a project officer, you know, and he got an opportunity to work with the CEO. So he utilized the opportunity and made sure that, you know, he, whatever small things, you know, rather than like some people, sometimes people may not go for the big things, you know, but you only have to, what you have to do when you've got certain projects, you just have to focus on that project and, you know, ensure that you actually got a strong foot within that project and get that done in a systematic way. So he did that, and now, you know, other opportunities are coming because the organization is growing. We have got a new business development unit, and we need a number of staff within that service because the, you know, the current structure cannot accommodate all this growth. So, so, you know, that's where the growth goes. So employers does view this in a very positive way, unless you know, you have got an individual agenda where, you know, things go in a different direction. But in generally, when you do such work, Australian employers are quite confident, you know, they feel good about it. It's primarily because it's always not a, you know, high growth area in Australia. So people's feedback and people's initiatives actually make a huge difference in organizations in Australia. So, and if you look at many of those examples, even in, you know, many big corporate world, you know, people would have come up with small ideas and that becomes a big business tomorrow. So employers know that people, you know, everyone has got good ideas in their mind and they really wanted to, you know, find out what is it so that they can leverage it. So it is positive if you see, if you do something which is outside of your scope and then, you know, for your future growth.
Thank you, Sulal. That was a very insightful discussion. I'm sure our viewers would have learned a lot from that.
Yes.
If you have any questions, please write to us at careeraustralia@m4tv.com.au. So until next time, bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.